And I think I'm going to talk a little bit about those remarks, even though I was supposed to talk about me. It's not so interesting, really. I was a local judge, and I met a man named Francis Greenberger, and we started the Greenberger Center in 2014 because of some personal history I'll tell you about in a minute. But just having some conversations before this panel about the history of mass incarceration and, frankly, the racism in the system, I really just wanted to take this time to have an opportunity to talk about that. You know, just, you may have heard this statistic, but we have 5% of the world's population, but we incarcerate 25% of the world's prison population. And it wasn't always like this. In 1970, we had about 350,000 people, or 550,000 people in prison. It steadily increased. And by 1990, we had 1 million, and today we have 2.2 million people in prison. And, you know, we have 65 million people with a criminal record. And, you know, you have to ask yourself, so are we just more dangerous? Are we more criminal? Or are Americans just, you know, a bunch of lawbreakers? Not so. It turns out it's the policies that we all support. It's the policies that our elected representatives put in place that have caused mass incarceration. I just want to read kind of the polite answer to why we incarcerate. It comes from an academic study by the National Research Council that was done a couple of years ago. And they said that the best single proximate explanation of the rise in incarceration is not rising crime rates. We're not criminals, all of us, or many of us, but the policy choices made by legislators to greatly increase the use of imprisonment as a response to crime. Mandatory prison sentences, intensified enforcement of drug laws, and long sentences contributed not only to high rates of incarceration, but also especially to extraordinary rates of incarceration in Black and Latino communities. So, let me tell you that now. That's the academic, you know, reason. Here's really what's happened. And after the Civil War, we had 4 million people, African Americans, that were free, and the Southern economy was in shambles. So what happened was that laws were changed. The Jim Crow laws were put in place, and Black people were rounded up en masse and put into prison, and they became slave labor and built up the Southern economy. This went on for about 100 years until the civil rights legislation came into play. And it was supposed to make everyone equal. But shortly after that, President Nixon was elected and developed what he called the Southern Strategy. And the Southern Strategy was really about criminalizing Black people and drugs. And it worked. I just want to read you a quote from Nixon advisor John Ehrlichman. He said, "The Nixon campaign in 1968 and the Nixon White House after that had two enemies, the anti-war left and Black people." You understand what I'm saying? We knew we couldn't make it illegal to be either against the war or Black, but by getting the public to associate hippies with marijuana and Blacks with heroin, and then criminalizing both heavily, we could disrupt those communities. We could arrest their leaders, raid their homes, break up their meetings, and vilify them night after night on the evening news. Did we know we were lying about drugs? Of course we did. It's not just Republicans, Democrats did it too. So Bill Clinton with his, you know, sentencing laws and militarization of the police departments fed right into that. So today we have 2.2 million people, mostly Black and Latino people, in prison. And that's horrible. The good news is it's starting to come down. Because people like you are starting to come to sessions like this and think about it and talk about it, and we're starting to kind of come to terms with this. And so while you may kind of have heard about some of these issues, what you may not have heard about is what the Greenberger Center does. And now I'll kind of get into what you asked me to do. So while we've been incarcerating Black people and Latino people for the last 40 years, the other people we're incarcerating is people with mental illness. So we used to have about 550,000 beds for people with mental illness in this country. We now have about 35,000. Today, if you have serious mental illness, you're 10 times more likely to be incarcerated than you are to be in a psychiatric bed. And what's happened is that deinstitutionalization has closed the beds. Well-meaning, Kennedy did it in the 60s. His sister had been lobotomized. He understood these issues. He knew there was a problem. He thought psychotropic drugs and therapy was going to help people have a better life. The problem was the community-based facilities weren't funded, and the fact is psychotropic drugs don't work on everybody. And so people came out. There was no reentry plan for them. They came out. There were no beds. And then the Vietnam War came, and the funding was shifted to the Vietnam War, and then Reagan actually made it into a block grant program. So all that money was put into other places, but not the seriously mentally ill, who ended up either homeless or, frankly, in prison, because they were engaging in activities that were related to quality of life crimes that people couldn't tolerate, and so they became a problem. Police were called, they were arrested. And today, about half the people of the 2.2, about 1 million of those have mental illness. And about 390 or so have serious mental illness. So we are incarcerating black, brown people and mentally ill people. And it really is time to change that. So I'm so glad that you're all here. The Green River Center is trying to change at least a piece of that related to mental illness. We've developed a first of its kind model in the country. We're trying to get funding for it for people who have serious mental illness who have been charged with a failed level crime. These are people who don't belong in prison, but they're going to prison because there's no alternative. So I can get into the details if there's time, but it's a kind of facility where they'll get up to 2 years of treatment, and then as part of a mandated plea with the judge, eventually be released into the community in a stepped down capacity. So the last thing I'll say is we got involved with this because Francis Greenberger's son has mental illness, his oldest son, and he was incarcerated. He ended up serving 5 years because he had two felonies. One was he tried to rob a cab, even though his father's a millionaire, billionaire. You know, he could have had the money, but he just impulsively, with mental illness, he just wasn't thinking clearly. He also has a co-occurring drug addiction, which many people with mental illness have. So, very briefly, he was out on bail. He became paranoid that a drug dealer was after him. He called the police to help him. The police came, and they saw his African-American and Hispanic caregiver. And they assumed that those were the drug dealers. They put handcuffs on them, went upstairs to see Morgan, realized what had happened, and decided, let's go let those people out of their cuffs, and they left. Well, Morgan was still in a panic, so he decided, I'm going to call the fire department. So he set a fire on his stove, watched it burn, called the fire department. They came, and he was arrested for arson. Because he knew that his caregivers were downstairs, it's a violent arson. It's a violent felony. And so there was no one that would take someone with a violent felony and a mental illness in an alternative to incarceration program. So Morgan took a plea of 5 years. He was at Sing Sing at times. He went around because he kept getting into trouble, because people with mental illness get into trouble when they're in prison. They can't follow rules. And to make a long story short, we couldn't help Morgan, but we are trying to help the next kid who does this. So I think I'm probably out of time. Thank you very much for letting me tell you about mass incarceration, but I felt it was really important.
We now have an alumni efforts. which support the Nunavut Act, they look to come under final release. And
what's your future goal?
We have been very lucky in the programming to be able to claim a less than 2% citizen rate in our 19 years compared to the 67% around the country. But I hate the fact that we compare recidivism with the good work we're doing. As someone that lived in prison and now home, I don't want my success to be based on the fact that I didn't go back to prison. There's so many other things that we are proud to be accomplishing and working on since release. So it's kind of a catch-22. A lot of the work that we do is measured by foundations because we didn't go back to prison, but all our real successes have happened on the outside.
And can you just say a word about why the prison museum is connected to why you feel a connection to this new initiative?
I think for the hustling students, having an opportunity to go to school has been associated with second chances. Really feeling like we've been getting a second chance of life through this opportunity that's been made an opportunity because of the community that supports it. So by relying on private funding, the men on the inside, men and women on the inside, realize that they're only getting this chance because folks care about them. And it's a kind of an odd sensation after your whole life feeling like you're alone to now know that you're not only not alone, but the people that care about you never even met. So that has translated into kind of feeling like you have a voice for a population that's pretty much known as being voiceless. So when they heard about this opportunity to be involved with the prison museum and the project, they were honored that they would be able to have a voice in the creation of this, but even more excited to know that that voice would translate into actual what it would look like again.
Thanks. Roger Panetta, historian, author, former of, I guess, emeritus professor at Fordham University. Can you say a few words?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
The first thing that you asked us to talk about is how we came to this topic, and I think that's important to the issue itself. I wrote about Dutch New York, Westchester suburb, Kingston during the IBM years, the Tappan Zee Bridge, and the Hudson River. And I published on all of those topics. And it dawned on me very slowly that I was in this neighborhood. And my instinct was to look at neighborhood history and things that were close by. And when I was teaching at Marymount, this was right under our nose. And I began to do work on that. And I began to see the juxtaposition of those two things and their blindness to each other, almost as if they were walled away from each other. It's really fascinating. So we, went to Sunnyside endlessly, but we hardly got to mention Sinkside. And with all due respect, the people that Historic Hudson Valley was, Sleepy Hollow Restorations, didn't exactly mention Sinkside a lot of times. So they were two different worlds, even though they were in close proximity. Even though many European visitors who came to Sunnyside also went to Sinkside. So their intellectual breadth was wider than ours was. And we created this sort of romantic haven. And that's what essentially drew me here, and I did a dissertation on the history of Sinkside in the 19th century, which is morphed into a book I'm working on now, called The Inescapable Shadow, The History of the Original Selmuk. And that inescapable shadow, I'll try to get to later, is really quite critical. You think a shadow is really cast from above by a second building. This is one of those anomalies in which I think the shadow is cast upward. And I would suggest to you, as to think about, and it's central to the validity of this museum, that the shadow that Sinkside casts, it casts over the whole issue of mass incarceration. In 200 years, between 1825 and 2025, Sinkside will have incarcerated approximately 100,000 men. 100,000 men. They will have served 500,000 years. What has to be an enormous statement on the failure of modernity. And what I wanted to start with tonight is, I wanted to use a slide, but I prefer not to do that, is with the idea that they are us. They are us. And the degree to which we do not see them that way, because we see evil, and there is evil there, the degree to which we do not see them that way is the degree to which we have ostracized them and turned them into the other. Some anomaly, something other than myself. This has not been helped by the separation of prisons and prisoners from the general population. So that decisive decision in 1825 to move the prison from Newgate, the first New York State prison, which had been an enormous disaster in spite of its Quaker foundings, to move it here with all of the inherent problems in the idea of punishment was really a very important moment. That's the original up the river, from Lower Manhattan to Greenwich Street, and then that simply gets grafted to here. So we not only get those inmates, we get the inherent flaws in that very institution from its very birth. And one of the things about the long, durable history of Sing Sing is how come in this country, and Sing Sing is a perfect representative of that, have we endured with this institution so persistently through valleys and peaks of reform and repression, even though there's ample evidence that it does not work? Why has this become the fixated institution? Sing Sing, really, the DNA of American penal history is in Sing Sing. That's what makes this museum so critical. Looking at it and studying it carefully, you begin to see in greater depth the way in which we are tied to this. If you buy that thesis, reform becomes more problematic. It's one thing to think of it as bad planning or bad thinking or poor administration. It's another thing to accede to the notion that it is in the DNA, the way racism, you know, what Hawthorne calls the sins of our beginnings, the sins of our origins, the sins of our founding. Is this one of those? It is as long and as old, the penitentiary really codates the founding of the Republic. It sits right alongside it. And you cannot separate the history of Sing Sing from the problems, the concerns, the anxieties we have about a republic becoming a democracy. Indeed, if we look at the profile of inmates today, the way Cheryl talked about them, and if you look at the profile of inmates in the 19th century, they have something in common. The scale is different, and so is the race. But they're all at the margins. Whether they be Irish immigrants, Italian immigrants, African-American immigrants, they all are at the margins. They are the ways in which we have managed the margins and continue to manage the margins. Not knowing the inmates, really, what do we see? I'm really very interested in that. What does the American public see when that word criminal prisoner comes into its mind? And that scene is really encrusted by all the social institutions of the media, film being one of the early ones. So the public's view of who that person is, a dehumanized view, largely conditioned by outside forces and media, is really a problem in the way in which we continue to sustain a system that we think is oppressive and dehumanizing. We can't see. Thus, the challenge for any prison museum is how do you make people see? And this is quite difficult because what are you going to show them? Are people going to want to come to a museum that unsettles them, that challenges their beliefs? Are they going to want to leave that visit shaken? Is any museum going to court that kind of audience? So the Sing Sing Prison Museum is at an historic moment where it has an enormous opportunity to break the mold. If we look at the two best models we have at Eastern State Penitentiary, which is an old model and which is extremely self-conscious about what it does and nervous about things it does that it does not do right, or things it does that really sort of skate along the edges, like having a Halloween night, which is the biggest generator of revenue, which the prison is open, the museum is open, and people run through on Halloween and you come into a cell and you get scared. That does wonders for bringing us in close proximity. The second example, the second best example, and everybody who's in the prison museum business has Alcatraz on the brain. Why? Because you have 1.5 million visitors paying $45 a pop. And it's run by the National Park Service that does not want to run it. It does not want to be in the prison museum business. So what it has done with all that money is build a refuge, a wildlife refuge, on the property. And it continues to shuttle people after because it does not want to get into the business. Why? Because it can't manage the narrative. So So what happens when you go to Alcatraz? You see Al Capone. And you can go into his cell and take a picture. Now, my goal here is engagement of the public with the average criminal life. Not the sort of, what I think, the entertainment issue of getting that picture in Capone's cell. The central question here, the central debate, is entertainment or education? And so far, my own studies of prison museums, they have a very hard time sorting that out. Because they're not sure about what to say. But if we want to engage with the question of mass incarceration, we have to open up the history of Sing Sing and look at the roots of that pattern. It's very critical also in talking about the othering. When inmates move from New York City to Sing Sing, where for the rest of its history, over 75% of the inmates will be urban residents, they separate those inmates from their environment, from their family, from all their connections. They also make the prison invisible. And in that invisibility, the public begins to imagine all kinds of things. In the early part of the 19th century, more people came and visited. By the end of the 19th century, it's increasingly becoming invisible, and therefore, I can imagine all horror stories there. And in that void, the media comes. Sing Sing is really a wonderful case study. It is both a place where films are made, it's a place that is the subject of films, it is a place where there is audience. Lewis Laws is showing films five times a week. Five times a week. Because it's a wonderful distraction, it's a placebo. It takes the edge off. And so it's a place where films are made, where it's also films are being shown, and surprise of surprise, some inmates are even asked for critiques of films. So what is that tight connection between films and Sing Sing? What does that tell us about its place in the public imagination? So I think the central question here is how we are going to do this. And it's not my business. When I worked on this in 1999, and we made a presentation to the Department of Correction, the real fear in the room was what was going to happen on Sunday when inmates, visitors, and family were on the same Metro North train as visitors to the museum. Or how are we going to prevent people from jumping into the electric chair for a selfie? And this was a real question because for 25 cents, you could sit in an electric chair in the White Plains Gallery at the same time we were working on this. So there are real issues here about how deeply and honestly this museum will confront the enormous complexity of it and how it will begin to unpack the problems of mass incarceration, which I'm suggesting to you is much deeper in the culture than we like to admit, and therefore much more difficult to extricate. In a recent essay, Adam Gopnik said, mass incarceration is the end of the 20th century's pretensions to humanity. The end of the 20th century's pretensions to humanity. I think this question is at the center of our own moral self-definition. How we are going to see that, which is why I want to come back to my first point. They are us. How do we begin to see this? We need, in these prison museums, to begin to show people the average inmate. We got a lot of candidates, and not the sort of glorious gangsters who simply feed, you know, the public fascination for that kind of thing, and don't move us one inch off our standing sort of exoticized views of who these inmates are. 19th century Sing Sing inmates, only 7% in the 19th century committed crimes against persons. I'll say that again. Only 7% of those inmates incarcerated at Sing Sing in the 19th century committed crimes against persons. Overwhelmingly, they were crimes against property. Their average sentence was 3 or 4 years. In some cases, the scale of the theft was so small. By the way, that's really interesting because that meant you had a revolving door here. You had about 400 to 500 inmates coming in and out every year here. which is very interesting. So if we begin to look at that, we begin to say, I really have to get closer to find out exactly who these inmates are. One of the things Sing Sing does, and it does it effectively, and it's probably one of the best national models, it turns the prison into a laboratory. I'd like to argue with you that the creation of a criminal class with all the social science apparatus associated with it is identified with the work that goes on in a place like this. Beginning with what Dana talked about with phrenology, an attempt to find a scientific explanation. But the place to study that is where you have subjects under your hand. This is the place where we use the Bertillon system. The Center for Bertillon Studies in New York State is at Sing Sing. You know, where the measurements of the body, the head, the ears, get to be more serious. This is the beginning of the fingerprinting file. It's the first psychiatric clinic in the United States for prisoners is here in 1917. What is all that about? To help improve a lot of inmates? Yes, primarily to help in the identification of what a criminal is. So to what degree is the penitentiary that laboratory in which that definition is fleshed out in a scientific way? How much it helps relieve the predicament of the inmate is also good.
Roger, I'm going to...
My last comment about this, I think this is a real litmus test and a real wonderful opportunity. The potential here to do something spectacular is right at hand, that we can break new ground, and that is my fervent.
In the spirit of conversation, and you've been sitting patiently waiting and listening, members of the audience, questions, comments? Yes?
I have a question.
Please stand and say who you are, if you can.
My name is
inside the prison system, but I think one of the things that's happened is the New York State Department of Corrections has done a really good job on the preparation of the GED and high school diploma, as well as the getting that diploma and then shepherding them to the college programs. There's 27 college programs in the New York State Department of Corrections that offer full degree granting opportunity. Then the Department of Corrections has utilized our students after completion to then work with those other students to find them in the cell blocks and push them toward getting an education. Many of our students, when first hearing about having an opportunity to go to college while incarcerated, are the first in their family to get that opportunity, but also don't feel they're capable. So the ones that have already gotten their degree and not gone home, because there's no correlation between finishing their diploma and going home, they're utilized by the Department of Corrections to help kind of sort out some of these other educational programs.
May I have your attention, please? The library will be closing in a half hour. Please note that the computers will be shutting down in about 15 minutes. Please save all your work.
Created a youth program that utilizes those men to interact with the local high schools. And that's the part that we're really talking about, the connection between the lack of an education and being incarcerated in the first place.
Expand your... I've had the privilege, really, to sit and other prisons around the country. And when I talk I'm struck by not only the educational deficits, but the trauma that they have been through. Every one of them has been traumatized, as typically as children, especially women. The statistics for women are about 90% of people, of the women in prison, have had sexual abuse or physical abuse, domestic violence abuse. So there are so many pressures and problems that come to bear on these folks' lives. And now not everyone that's traumatized ends up stealing something or ends up hurting other people, obviously, but the fact is, without exception, almost people that are incarcerated have had very traumatic lives. Dyslexia is important, but I think interventions at school, right from early on, when these things are happening, we need to be more vigilant about it and get help to these kids before they become adults.
Yeah,
I think it also raises, for me anyway, resonates with my larger concern, and that is they are us. What you're really saying is take a close look and get out of the situation, which we use that broad category of criminal class, prisoner, to then embrace everybody. And I think if you look at the records of the 19th century inmates, and you look at the admissions registers, what you begin to see is what Superintendent Carpenter talks about, really, broken people. Broken people. So if we began to look more closely and got away from the stereotyping and the othering, we begin to see the kind of nuance you're talking about, and then our attitude toward punishment will really get much more complex.
My name is Alicia Simpson, and I own a nonprofit called the Paso Rioja Project.
What's it called?
Paso Rioja Project.
Paso Rioja.
And we use a trauma-informed mindfulness and creative art therapy to help kids who are in rehab centers with past trauma. Brought up also the idea of our policies. And policies are the real issues of why we have the kids that are in schools and going into prison and having these problems, because we have shaped policy over time to punish people. This is everyone's pointed out. But when you're saying that they're broken, I don't think they're broken. I think that they're just unable to kind of work their way back up because everything keeps going against them over and over. And I just really wanted to thank everyone here, because I wasn't aware of the reform that Simpson was doing. So I was really very moved to hear that this is happening. But we really, really need to, which we brought up initially, and I really think it's important for everyone to understand this. We're living in fear of everything that happens to us. We look at what's happening right now in our community and who's our president, and we are based, everything he does putting us in a position where we are afraid of something. And then we have to change the way that we react to it, because we're afraid that we're going to lose something. There was someone by the name of Naomi, something who made this thing called shock doctrine. So when you're putting people in prison and you're doing all these horrible things to them, they come down to this way of demeaning themselves like a child, and they're going to do whatever they can do to come back and to get whatever they can, so they can feel like they're regaining again their strength. So I really want to thank all of you for doing what you're doing. I just, it's really more of a comment to be like, I'm really excited for this, and you know, would love to hear more about this, and I hope to go to more just to see all that.
Hi again. Lynn Lawson. I'm very close to the Central Museum since you're housed in my office, and it's been a pleasure to have everybody come in. And I've realized something very important in the process since being a landlord, which is that this museum is very different, as you mentioned, with a lot of words, but I'm going to try to say as much with less. This is very different than anything that I have been in. It's going to be a living entity. It's going to be a pulsating, living entity, where the boundaries between history, the dust, and the current and the future is going to be very dynamic. And I think that's sort of what gives me goosebumps. And I think that is where museum, as we call it, is no longer something that's sitting on the shelf. Museum is a life experience. And there's no better opportunity than here. It encompasses the entire village. It encompasses people who live here, the people who come through, the people who work here. It encompasses inmates, guards. And I think by doing this, as you were saying, we are trying to, I can see you are trying to create the level playing field. And I think that's the most fantastic thing that I can see happening. So I am really hoping that the issue, the point of the business deal is going to happen, is also coming out very strongly today. Because I think you all have the opinion and the knowledge, and some of it at least, of what is wrong with our system. But I think it's very important to embrace what this group has worked so hard and so long to start getting to happen. So I really hope that everyone here understands that this is a very big step forward, and I just want to say that it's fantastic.
Thank you. Yes.
I'm Lila McDowell, the development director at Hudson Lake. I love what you said, President Meta, about the central tension between entertainment and education. It's the same thing that I was like, thinking without being able to articulate, like, what about this makes me uncomfortable? So thank you for bringing that out. And I wanted to ask Sean, who frankly this is my boss.
Nice one.
I know you don't speak for formerly incarcerated people everywhere, but just you as an individual. What could this museum look like or do that would make you feel like walking through it, like, wow, this communicates and educates about, you know, historical institution and that's shaped criminal justice throughout history in a way that doesn't sensationalize or play into voyeurism about, like, hundreds of years of human.
I think for me, there's a huge assumption that Officer Bobkinski and his comrades were completely against me as I served my 20 years in prison. And the fact of the matter is, New York is one of only two states that sentenced the teenagers as adults. So when I was 16, I got in trouble in the ninth grade. I got a 24-year prison sentence. When I entered that Massachusetts Supreme Prison, because it wasn't a special place for teenagers, I shouldn't be here in front of you right now. I should be a completely different person. If what everyone is saying is kind of true, there's a piece that's missing where the first thing the officers did was take care of me. The older men that lived there schooled me as a prison term. They taught me about life and who I was, and there's this whole misconception that the teenagers are being abused by the older men. And just to put it in perspective, there's only 54 prisons in New York. I lived in 9 Massachusetts prisons before I was 24. I have the broad view here. I didn't live in one place for a few months and get out and now write a book. And I hate to say it that way, but this is just honest talk that I lived and was raised by the New York Foreign Correctional Officers in a way that no one wants to hear. No one wants to hear that I was raised and did well. I'm not recommending it. Not saying to send your kids there. My mom and dad were New York City cops. I was the one that was there. My, you know, my grandmother thought I went to college. I should have been a doctor. I was gone quite a while. But the fact is, it was a very tricky place to grow up in. I had some guidance. And I'm not saying that all the officers were great. I'm not certainly not saying all the men that lived there were great. I met some amazing people. And I wouldn't be who I am today if I didn't go to that place.
You know, I think that what he's saying to us today brings to me very critically is how does the museum humanize the experience? And when you hear Sean talk, you get a sense of that. And I think letting that, humanizing that experience and letting it sit in front of an audience, not in a didactic way, but letting it sit and be absorbed so they leave with a much more nuanced view of what that experience is. That's incredible. And I think what he's doing is illustrating what that whole thing.
Laura?
Yes, my name is Laura Rossi, and I have a question about the story, because I thought your presentation was phenomenal. And I'm curious your thoughts. The first person who has your position 100 years from now, after this museum has been built and people have come through this village, this place, what will that person have to say about the relationship between the same directional facility and the people who live in the museum?
Well, I mean, there's a whole book to write about that, for sure. And you know, the village as a prison was very defined for a long time. It's only in the last 30 to 40 years it's become as separate as it is, and that for a lot of reasons. But a lot of people's dads worked as guards, a lot of people's moms worked as secretaries. You know, I talk to lots of people who drove meat trucks in there when they were 16 to deliver the meat, and who really went to baseball games and played. There used to be a lot more interaction. And that ended a lot, for all intents and purposes, unless you were a volunteer in there. And when I think people will look back at the relationship of the village and the prison, and I hope through the museum arrive at a constructive and thoughtful relationship with it. Because, you know, the fact is, Ossining's an awesome place, that we've got a correctional facility here. And some people, I remember I had a boss who said to me, you can't live in Austin. Because I worked at a fancy company. You can't live in Austin. I'm like, yeah, I can. 30 years, hello. And that they will look back and they will see that maybe we will have come to a better understanding of who is there and why. And I would like to see there to be more of the residents, they don't have to, but to become more involved and more understanding of the place and not so much as a place of otherness, which it very much is. It used to be the guards, I mean, the stories you would hear, the kids would put candy in the guards' buckets and they'd pull them up and, you know, they'd go stand and watch the basketball. You can still watch the basketball from State Street. But it really used to be way more interaction. Austin was called a gritty prison town, which not everybody, you know, today would like to be called that, I suppose. But we're not gritty. We still have the prison. To me, maybe we should look at ourselves and try and think of it in a way that we can feel good about that.
You know, Laura, I think that's the question.
When I look at the reforms, I feel a little bit proud about some of the stuff that happened.
Yeah, I think the question is a fundamental question about how are we going to measure our success? How are we going to know that we achieved these goals that I mentioned at the beginning? And I think that some of what we're doing tonight of pulling the curtain back on this story that has been really invisible. And I think this idea of segregating the prison experience and what life is like for the average everyday prisoner, it's been so sensationalized, there's so much misinformation that I think if we're successful to reintroduce this subject in a way that talks about the moral implications of incarceration, the history, because I believe history is a resource for understanding our own times.
One of the things that we say at our meetings are that the Sing Sing Prison Museum could be part of the solution. And we become part of the solution to create the change so that our lives, all of our lives are improved. They're improved because people who are exiting from prison actually are prepared to be in the world and they're productive. That's a wonderful thing to happen. That'll help everybody who's not in the prison feel safer about what's going on in the prison. So I think that being part of the solution, you know, to be able to, for history to say, you know, in Ossining, we made history. It was changed. Well, our lives are better for what they did there. That would be the greatest.
What she said.
Thank you all very much. Thanks so much.